extended the time. Why is it actually really for us? Why do we have music at all? Is the first question. There was a tradition, the Ben Morrison they call it, which was recorded in northern North Hampshire in the woods, where the elements seemed to be rhythm and noise, and no melody instruments. In other words, like the African business sort of rhythmic noise, drums, sticks, bells, and things like this, it can be incredibly exciting when actually no melody, no involved at all. I'd like to think of more size today. And in a sense, the success of rhythm dance. If you start to listen to the music, it's almost out of the way there. You realise that it's a quality of sound in the day, and not very rhythmic sense. The folk music in the British Isles, particularly in England, is a rhythmic noise rather than a quality noise. It was at the time of Bach, the music was written there very simply, just trying to train you up to play with do the orientation on themselves. Dominated by the drum, the drum for the excitement. There is an enormous dance to the mind of the field, rather than something actually that the audience is meant to listen to in particular. So, the tradition in England, as we're aware of it, had a few musicians who were very good. Arnold would be an uncle, a great uncle, a brother. He played for all, he had a dance for all. They would take on a bicycle and bring the various players, put the dance floor, and he and his brother and his son would play, and people would play on the bicycle. So, they weren't great players, and they probably weren't English country players in the way that it's modern with those people. I say modern with the John Patrick, the English country music was playing in Stowe. And he seems to play something so extra basic, quite unbelievable. And the basic pulse when he's playing 8 or 12 or 16 beats per hour is quite fast and quite insane. And I can come back to talk about the excitement and speed. So the recording. Nature of body movement. Playing 4/4 rhythms takes longer. You know, if you want to be your eye out of the brain, then you run out pretty longer than you start. Therefore, you have to play slower than you would have done so. So there isn't a standard speed for the loss. Now that brings me to the question, what is the rhythm we actually dance to?
Thank you.
Sometimes works in a chorus where you look tic-tac. a difference between what I would call the classical Cox and Morris of 1860, which is really what the revival tried to capture and teach, the field change, Sherborne, Longbourn, things of that sort. The Morris went a bit more complicated. Compared with the Morris of the 20th century, and by that I mean the Acton, Camden, Bidford and so on, which have basically simplified, if it's ever complicated at all, they offer a very simple interpretation of stepping and of elementary form of dance. Now that brings me really to come back to Bampton. If you're Bampton with single steps, what would be a sensible dance to do? None of them are sensible. What do you do? If you have your single. Right, next. Let's try and see what these basic are. The way a Bampton young man is taught to do the Bampton step is they are taught to do this and then to kick off the top. Thank you. Chip and Camden. Right.
Which one is that?
That's the option for the number one. you technically physically get a result, you can't do it. We are conditioned, rightly so, that Ronnie Green goes to a certain sort of place. And now then, we approach it with a different point of view. We can do chicken candle or any way of doing good practice. It isn't easy. It does get set in the routine mode of actually moving your body to the view. You get the same problem with the moment of knowledge as you were trying to explain.
I personally have no objection, and I don't think most other musicians do, if somebody says, can you speed up or can you slow it down? What I do object to is everybody struggles through it, and I try very hard to meet this morass of six different demands, and then at the end, Squire comes up and says, that's way fast. The time to say that is during Once to Yourself. And the other thing, really, is with Squire's foreman or whatever, to try and tell me what it is that they want. Because I don't think that a lot of beginning squires or foremen have paid enough attention to the music when they were learning to dance to be able to get the point across when they're trying to tell a musician, well, what I want is, and particularly things like the way you want to get into and out of slows in ducking turn or virtually any other tradition. There are an enormous number of different ways of playing that, and probably the only one really fits the style of the foreman wants. If you pay no attention to be able to say, if you could just drag that or put a bit of lift in on the way in, and then as Roy said, you may have lost that time completely, or you may make it up elsewhere to compensate for the dance to come down. The more explanation that we have as musicians, the more chance you've got by the end of the second season the music being passed.
Well, when I invited the Hal Fleet, they told me that he had a degree of stone hardcore and ducking. And I thought, that's good, I've made up two of those. I couldn't see a problem. It took me 2 years to actually play such a way that they could adapt their dancing to see it where I was playing. Despite the fact we both had particular very strong ideas as to how it ought to be done, the subtle differences were actually hard to accommodate where you fit. Now the problem this thing is that this is house style. The particular group of people you've got dance in a particular way, or they're not used to dancing in a particular way. And actually pretending that we dance different traditions is really, as I said, a bit of a myth. We actually dance the way we do. We actually attempt different movements and different figures, the underlying style, the rhythm of movement and so on tends to carry across from one tradition as it were to another. Inevitably. It's unavoidable, but there's no pretending that you really ought to do it differently. There may be the case for some, as two traditions which are quite distinct from each other, good luck to them. I don't really say it's worth other people's trouble. Actually trying to get
standing around waving your arms at you, jumping down, doing a bit of dancing, saying there, that's where it's going wrong. But, if you may not feel that your actual presence are very big, you may have problems knowing exactly what's wrong. But certainly the decision on hand eventually, if it works out what it was doing. Shut up playing the way you normally play. Play something I can follow in a tight situation.
science of FPA is making you stand up and play in front of other people, two other people, is actually quite important. I'm in debt with one of my scholars, who I've known him for many years, on the basis that they were only prepared to dance the best musician of the rain. And all the rest were told perhaps you do better off than us. No encouragement for the people who were learning. And that doesn't actually come from the side at all. That's acting officers of behaving as a group. With a group, you don't say, you're good, you're bad. You say, these are more experienced, but you're not. They're concentrating on bringing you up to the speed that we're all on and so on. And also within that is a recognition that sometimes the best dancers or the best musicians will have to lower their standards. The others they're working with. Right? You actually grow a little bit. And now, we keep coming out of business with speed. What's the right speed for Morrison? But there is a fundamental problem that when you play slow, when you play something nice and slowly, like all 60 or even sorrowful, you know. excitement from the music. It all has to come from the movement itself. So you have to be athletic with things like that. Most of the tunes that Sharp collected are at 96 beats to minute. Now that means nothing to most people. If I say it's 4 bars in 5 seconds, you can try it on a clock.
As we did.
There's a challenge.
96. Say something to like tea break at 3:30.
Outside.
Thank you. when you start as a foreman or squire of the side, you don't start just as a group of traditional immigrants owning what you picked up. You've actually had a positive education that a number of issues you have to think of possible solutions like that. But I see emphasizing federation because I believe that of all problems that exist, somebody somewhere has met it before. And one of those probably has a solution. Yeah. So we've got to attack the experience, but we have to do it in a structured way. So we start with something like this. I don't imagine I'm going to run the reason for it. I can well see that in workshops, the workshop meetings, to get people together around here to do rather things and actually sort out what it is. A teacher's training. Well, I mean, coming away many things, I suppose, we're getting to the stage of technique, dance technique. Just a matter of style, there are some fundamental things underlying all of that. The thing about style is we've collected, I suppose, a great order of 23 possible traditions. Maybe possibly 120 that might have existed one time or the other. So we already start, we only know 20% of what was done. Yeah, as they were all different, we've imagined that they had their certain all different as well. So when people start creating traditions, you come back and say, oh, that's not traditional, it's not the slightest idea, really. the team, those people who got over this first plateau, you didn't actually see the challenge of opening anymore. You know? They set it for their long, steady decline. They weren't actually going to, didn't see they had any more technique to learn. They could do it. They could do all these positions. We practiced 100 dances, I remember one side saying, no, over the years, I can do them all. You know, what do I have to learn? Why do I have to practice? Why do I have to come to practice? You know? Why do you get upset with me? And this is because of things, there isn't this recognition that in fact your own skills are improving all the time. You know, not only more confident, you actually have better control of yourself, and you have to do that. So within front of say, well, all right, yeah, I recognise you're doing better, but what? Actually just doing better than me. But one thing you can do, one thing is characters of components through the world, that as much in England, is the anticipation. When you're doing a classical ballet, you're interpreting music, and the interpretation, you can't interpret where you've got to, because classical music is non-repetitive, not like poetry, it changes all the time. You have to interpret when you get it. With the Morris, white country dancing, you know what's going to come next, you know exactly, and you're ready for it, which is why, as I said this morning, the drama is the pulse. Thing adds the excitement to it. What doesn't add excitement to it is the sloppy, the slow acceleration into the movement is sloppy. It's the only word for it. It doesn't look as if it's got any drama to raise it, and that's what the audience I also appreciate, they don't appreciate it, they actually see that this slackness in the way you drive, you've got it, that drama into it and so on, which means you're going to be ready for the next movement. It doesn't mean that when you come to the end of the figure, you jump, that in the jump into the air, you turn into the next figure. But the fun for Morris in the early days used to take lots of pictures, and then realised I was always a quarter or an hour turn into the next movement. And they weren't, there were five after a beautiful, they were me off. yes, you should do it like that. But it's being ready, you know exactly what it is. You're already, when you're landing for the jump, you know where you're going to push off, you know what sort of. It helps to understand the effect, the origin of the movements. It helps to understand that the basic classic Morris step comes out of the flat. Here's the flat four and the excitement of getting back to it. The trouble is, of course, pretending that you're intending to kick your foot forward, which they actually thought would turn to spring up in the air. Kicking the foot is actually the consequence of jumping and balancing yourself. The emphasis is on the nose. And we had difficulty, I think, in persuading the audiences. We had to get him off the ground after being an audience. Capers, slow capers, all these sort of things. Origin of the Galliards, origin of Jesus, stage, the things on the side, they're all part of showing off and so on. Slow capers, one that used to be competitive and so on. None of you were trying to look better than the other. But all that sort of element that we actually want. Having said that, I mentioned right at the start the Alexander technique. Now, unfortunately, with this, you've got to unlearn a lot of the things you're habitually able to do to get a better posture. Now, the aim of a better posture isn't actually able to stress in the body, to actually be more comfortable in the body a bit longer. In effect, you know, you don't stress yourself, you don't have heart attacks, and that sort in quite the same way. Where do we see it? Well, the English Cotswold Morris has a stiff torso. We don't actually wave the upper body around. Now that's one of the body language that's typically English, you know, of this defensive business of not actually moving yourself around, not expressing yourself. So it's one of these things we have to make up in mind in tradition that you're going to be something like that. normal life, we don't believe programming in the way we do in the forest. At least, not in my knowledge, not to my knowledge. One thing I think we've learned in 40 years is we don't dance with pain. All that does is make it worse. Right? Sprains and things like this, as soon as you get it cold, a pack of frozen peas, type of approach and so on, getting it cold. So I've got this night when I was young, maybe you got a bird and you stuck butter on it. Nowadays you stick it in a tap. You have trouble with your legs for a number of reasons. You must all, by pressure, if you walk around, you will notice that your feet roll. That's all you know. You should notice your foot pronates, i.e., as you do it, it rolls side to side. There's no reason. In some of your body, it's easy to see. whether you like it or not, it's not back to that game and you're holding it. And the way that's corrected is by having an insert in your shoe which shows you over. If you've ever had brought up children who have troubles and things, you'll all go through the phase of having something put in their shoes, which they hate, they don't understand why they're doing it. But the Morris, because it's basically same thing is that problems with your knee, typically, it's a funny joint, really, bend walking. It's something like limited bend rotation this way, basically out there in rotation, not the knee's kind of a difficult one to get right, and so on. And as a result of that, we find the stress that appears elsewhere. You know, you get a couple of nerves. Yes.
they say has a fairly rigid set of words for things. You know, you could get someone to describe what you have to do, but you don't know what they are.
You try to
describe it. Oh, I have. I've written an essay on it. It takes a lot of words, but there are the words there, but I agree, there isn't a set of words for this kind of
thing. Well, when the Federation was sort of originally started, it meant phrases like step onto the other foot. That's right, everybody does that. An ambiguous language is actually difficult. Right? But we need that because you can't just capture on video or film. You know. I mean, I do believe one time you could, but having spent a day trying to film without doing a Jew and decided at the end that in fact we didn't actually illustrate what I wanted to illustrate at all. You know, we were actually going to spend a lot of time rehearsing some of our to get the message over that we actually do. So we do need a terminology. We haven't got one. Now, the band notation people recognise all the problems of having to describe the bits of movement and so on. The actual notation I use is hard to learn. And the advice from the organisation, well, we did an exercise, we're trying to do an exercise with them, of taking film of, you know, 10 boundary film in 3 boundary size and ask the New York people whether they can actually distinguish in their rotation between the 3 sides. And they said, we consider that yes, but in terms of simple terms, no. What they do is describe what we would look back to, but not the subtle variation. Starts out with subtle variation of music, it really is counterproductive to try and recall all the fine detail in the way you need to have it done in the record. But as you know, the problem with video is that you capture one occasion. And anybody who actually did video, they turn and say, well, that's how I normally do it, you know, I do it like this. And you realise there's a tolerance band from what they do. You know, you capture one off event and one off way of doing it, and possibly a normal way of doing it. So I think that's probably not so good. That's not good. I'd like to move my reading system ahead to the floor. Everybody talk about the purpose of it. I don't know. Ready?
Thank you.
like all our good dancers, it's stolen from somebody else. There's something special about stealing a dance from somebody else. This comes from the Broadwood men who invented our horseshoe tradition, whose figures are interesting but really don't suit us. But the stick tap is great fun because we can do it both with six or with eight. Or with anything, you know, it fits into anything. And I appreciate it. Choruses and figures really don't have much to do with each other.
Thank you.
And show where we started the dance with five, the sixth man turned up, picked up six steps and said, did one clash, knocked the top of the socks, cigar, up the steps, hit the foreman in the side of the face and threw him off the hospital. Stitches, and we're back to five again. The best story that I ever found is the wood used by the Forestry Commission for their brushes for beating Hector Blaine with the static side of the tree for many years. I find your coppice wood, you get something to write down on the leg, solving is difficult nowadays, people don't coppice. But if you can, try to get an hour long, or a meter long, if you're that way inclined. Store it for at least the winter, dry it. You must get the wood seasoned. If you're using it green, you're going to have troubles. And again, you're advised to not to store it in such a way as it collects the work of bone. And buy it back to the pile of the so it can be good. Traditionally, most of the time, both sides are painted their sticks. We just don't do this anymore. The average stick was 27 inches long, maximum 24 to 27 across the side. The 33 inch stick in England is a strictly category stick, was not used in any other tradition along to it. Again, big sticks are much easier to show off, so we tend to get it up to the end. The trick that you need to know about the stick is you hold it between your thumb and first finger in that notch, basically. You don't grasp it all the way round, because you get white knuckles, it's not a white knuckle voice. That gives you the ability to use your other fingers to keep it around, rotate, and do whatever you need. Right? In other words, really is no difficulty in throwing a stick if you hold it like that and then rotate your arm. Yes, all right. It doesn't come easily. All the members, when your daughter of four goes on to bat and twirling tea and does it no different to both hands, you realise you just got something in your child. So it's actually quite easy to twirl, but it only applies to Bracken and Hidden as far as nobody ever worked out their own tradition with twirling that I'm aware of. But the point of holding is that when you come to dance a race, you need to hold it either going up or some way that suits your pace style or eight. Grab it like that, go in with a tournament fashion, charging other people in their posterior or whatever it is with the stick. You have to be watchful for that. So you need this ability to control, and that's why you hold it like that. Now that's all we were, until you clash with somebody. Because if you just hold it like that and clash. It's not a substantial enough grip. So what do you do when you clash? That's the moment when you tighten the grip on the hand. Right? Now all the problems, dangerous movements come with the Morris. When somebody forgets to clash, now you do that, and for some reason or other they're not there or something like that. And the problem is the people who don't raise too much, who follow through. It's the follow through, which although it's the right way to play sports, like tennis and so on, is not the right way to know. What you do with the Morris is that you try to grip where you're supposed to hit and stop. It gives you a brighter clash noise anyhow, so in fact it's good technique, right? Just hit and grip at that moment. So in fact it doesn't bounce around, it doesn't fly off or anything like that. It's the safest way and it's the best technique because you get the best sound it gives you. The very best sound, of course, comes out of pine. The pine's good because it dries and like that, it shatters in your hand. So that's why I was fun for it like that and see it all fall in bits. There was a sign, who was it I saw using ex-seeding lards? go, because that didn't do it. They like what they saw, so the next spot they're on were over there, all sticks of rock. You know, we did stick outs, because you don't have stick outs, we did stick outs and sticks of rock, breaking off a bit for the big crater keeps all the way around it, so we all did it. Not something you do on the bridge, you know. That's the first bit. We've got the same bit, you know, you hit and you hold it. You have to practice it on the grade. You need that to give you. The next thing is when you're all stood for the stick tapping, you're all caught back on your heels. So when you came off to move into the figure and so on, everybody had to rotate and move. No smartly in rhythm. Now if that had been up at a six and a half penny dance, you know, it would have been very noticeable that you were behind the time. Can I have, is there enough please so we can do British Grenadiers before?
Thank you.
well. I won't really say much. That's because I'm trying to compress into a day or really should be 2.5. Perhaps now I've got me quiet. It's a good point to say. I, along with our technical new technical officer, would like feedback for today. Not just the sort of standard feedback, did you enjoy today, why on earth did you waste all this money? But in terms of, hey, I have an experience, I have an anecdote, I have something to say, I believe you all prepared me well. What we will do, if you need a list of what the program was and headings, I'll provide that to the technical officer. But what we'd like people to feed in, we'll edit these together as a bundle and circulate that again to people who reply, because the only way we'll move forward and find out what it is we have to take note of is for everybody to contribute. If you feel like contributing, anybody who says no is rubbish is also will be welcome, because perhaps they might be your own. Right, I have a set. We're going to talk about shows. You know, it's all very well aware about technique, it's all very well about being a group, all the other things, but in the end, the only thing that matters is actually when they're outside and looking like this. Right? Now, what have we learned so far? It matters. The first 4 minutes I was getting there, having somebody there at the spot they advertise on time. So the local old folks who actually struggle there to watch you are not left wondering whether they're in the right year or the right day or something like that. Having somebody there is so tiny for getting on, standing as if you're actually there, meaning what you're doing rather than doing preening actions or sorting out your cufflinks or carrying your hair or generally feeling embarrassed or standing there doing battle while somebody announces. Now, the doing the dance part is easy. That's the thing you've practiced all the time. Which is why I'm not asking you to do it at the moment. You might confirm that to somebody that you can do.
Why bother the apple there?
Honest man, isn't he? You do wear that sort of thing. Right. So we got there. They do their dances and so on, and that's all about. Now, what are the problems that go with the show? One of the problems is, in fact, what do you do with the people who aren't dancing? Right? Margaret and I ran a campaign for many years about people who will stand in front of people who are watching, particularly older people like myself. You know, the dancers somehow imagine that when they're not dancing, they're invisible. Right? Unfortunately, it's not true. It's just wishful thinking. And therefore, the first thing you worry about when you're doing a show is, where do I put all the rubbish? Where do I put the inactive dancers who are not inactive, they're actually getting in the way? And so on. What do we do between the dancers? Do we all branch off and then form up again? Do some people walk off and other people come on? What do you do? It doesn't really matter. You have to be organised. Right? And you have to be aware of it. Great to actually have a band of 15 standing in a long line across here with the crane behind you. We've met that. We've even met it at Windsor. Right? Ex-dancers, their friends come and stand in front of you as well, which is also bad. It gives the Morris a bad image. Well, I don't like anything. The other thing I've actually done, we did a similar one here, we produced it as the form for the audience to fill in. You know, it said, I did enjoy or didn't enjoy, or names because of, you know, things of that sort. And you pass around the audience to give to the bus, them to feed back to the busking site. I think we lost a fair number of friends that way. They also, I think, got a few messages. So they're doing their show, they're trying to worry about the body language, trying to get a good impression, so on. They're trying not to obstruct the crew and things of that sort. They worry about it. Now, what attitudes that they have towards each other in dancing. Well, this is the business of dancing in pairs, or as a set, worrying about the lines, you know, but it's much trying to dance together and look as if they're a group, but we're together, which means eye contact within the set. And also, don't stare over the heads of the crowd. You know, it's fairly obvious you know, when you stand up, they're all looking like that. They're all looking like that, you know. They're all trying to avoid being seen. It's ostrich-like, you know. Just because your head's in the sand doesn't mean you're not there. Right? So you really have to accept the fact that you're the stupid one who stood up dressed up in front of the audience, and you're going to have to interact with them whether you like it or not. Now, the thing that goes with interacting are the characters. And by the characters, let's call them the MC, the clown, the hobby horse, these things, remember. What are their roles? Well, if one's quite honest, you can get by without it. You must have seen many on our side who actually did a complete show without saying a word to the audience. They hardly word to each other except being insulted. Former didn't like what they did, the swine didn't agree with the form, and so on. You know, never do your post-mortems in public. You know, you have a weekly meeting called practice to work out the things that you can't stand. And also, usually a sufficient gap between the practice doing it and having a row for the simmer down. The worst sort is the row in public. And so on. If things go wrong, they go wrong. They go wrong in practice as well. This is not the time to worry about it. We have this background. Well, first thing, we have a foreman at the side, another one. Convention person does the announcements. Right? Now, there are tricks about doing announcements, but what's the role? Well, we're coming back to body language immediately. Body language depends on how far you are from somebody else. If you stand closer within your personal space, it actually is a different relationship when you're standing further apart, or a long way apart. These people are close enough that they're actually recognisable in social contact. They're not physically touching, because the Fox or Morris doesn't include physical contact. Not normally, it's a separate. But they are within each other's personal space. They're close enough to actually recognised by the people outside of you that I'm working with. But you're not in their personal space, you're in the distant space, right? And their reaction to each other is different from their reaction to you. You are remote. When this number one does his speech about whatever it is, he's being remote from all of you. Now, it doesn't matter who he's addressing, or how he's addressing, you know, he's actually the tame crowd type thing, making a general announcement. He's not actually addressing you, you know, or you, and so on. That's not the job of the number one. The next job you get is the clown, right? Now that's an interesting character, because the clown is not actually part of the Morris. He's actually part of the crowd. He's the person of the crane who does the dance to the dancers what they will have to do, but better not. Right? The crane, in other words, is attention to the record. He's on your side, right? You know, you know what we're going to do, so don't you? So they dance there. That's right. Are you going to play? Well, I don't know. They said they knew what they were doing as much as they ever did.
A size 7 half eight.
Thank you. is actually about mocking the great, as it were. Now, you know, the English, you know, love to make mockery of the Queen, things of that sort. And you have somebody who's actually disruptive up to a point with the Morris. Now, the important thing about anybody who claims to be disruptive is you don't repeat yourself. The trouble about repeating things you do is that, first of all, it gets boring to the person who's on the receiving end. To cope with being boring, next time, you make it a little worse. And a little worse. And a little worse, until such time as they then throw you in the pond. At least, as it happened to me with Bath once, isn't it? That is the point. Something you have to teach university size, studies are great, but you don't keep repeating. You have to be spontaneous, not rehearsed. One of the worst things at all when I'm in Morris, is they were great fun on the first show, but the second show, which is Michael, doesn't work. You have to be spontaneous, but it's sort of you. So a clown, as I say, is interacting, coming with a bloody audience on their side. And you notice the typical clown, if you go to the circus, goes around and looks at the audience, eye contact for a few moments, seconds, as it were, of each one. And by the time you've gone around the whole group of the audience, you have met the audience, they met you, you know, you're all on their side, and so on. Then you look at that lot and say, what am I going to do? And then, which will make them worry. You don't have to do this, you have to threaten to do it, you know, it's a deterrent posture. At least the Russians are supposed to be aware. That's just two characters. Now, what about the hobby horse? Well, the hobby horse is a sort of clown in general, but it comes under the heading of what the French call the musicals. The bus have a number of characters who are there to look interesting. You don't have to do anything. A hobby horse is too big, and so on, to get into get some people's way, you know, in a disastrous sort of way. But it can be very attractive. And because it's a difficult thing to use, you need a very experienced dancer to do it. Someone who knows what's going on, what we can interfere, what we can do, and you can do the dance and not be the dance. So the animal might be something that somebody who's not prepared to dress up as a clown could do because it's more anonymous. That's part of it, the fun games and so on. Basically, they're there for the use of children. But they're not the only jobs that have to be done. There's also the job of a person who's in the crowd, who's while the crowd and not part of the show. They're bound in its soul by having somebody with a collecting box and a cake, or somebody in the crowd who actually has leaders and just walks around casually chatting to people. And somebody you go up to and say, what the hell are they doing? You know, where did they come from? And all those sort of things. It doesn't have to get rid of the audience during the show. That actually has that role. And the final role that is important, it's all on, what used to be called the ragman. And that was who is actually looking after all the junk that goes with Morris team. Now, the coats, the bits of equipment, the things are all heaped somewhere or other. If there's to be heaped paper away, somebody has to look after them. Right? And that person is then your substitute, your backup for everybody. Usually an older, in the tradition, an old retired dancer would come along to be helpful. In this case, a husband or something of that sort. So are all these roles. And why I mention these is that we start off by saying, what's the problem when you have a large club? And the problem with a large club is that the experienced dancers actually want to do the experienced dancers, leaving the beginners to do the beginners' dancers. So you have a club and a club, which is not satisfactory for just those people who you're trying to encourage to take a leading role. They're the people who are not beginners, who are not going to be a clown, or the MC, or organise a show, and things like this. That needs experience. You have to be aware of it to dress up, make a fool of yourself, probably in that sort of way. So there's actually a role for almost a side worth of people who are actually doing critical things for the Morris, who actually aren't actually dancing, but we do require experience.
So you can get yourself into the situation where perhaps you've got 8 or 9 dressed dancers who are the core of people doing the shows, and 5 or 6 other people who also part of the party who all have also have an essential role. Perhaps you tend to think, well, somebody doing the names is not a terribly important role. But I had that experience for a couple of years inside. I dressed up in tortilla jacket and so on, you know, lucky MC. And my friend was not only doing the names, but you actually, they're the only person who's actually watching the crowd with their response, the only one who could actually structure the show and say, well, it's time we stop, time to enjoy it. Good night, come to the sun. Actually, MC the show while they're working from a printed program. It is very difficult for a foreman who's dancing at 9 or 1 and has to control the team and its performance, at the same time be able to control the audience. And it's very easy to start dancing and discover it all disappeared in the shopping centre halfway through the dance and you didn't notice it going. And I have no idea why they all walked away from you, which might be something you're doing. And that really brings me to the matter of standing. Thanks very much. You actually performed one with me there. Some of the lessons of washing off other people. Standards. It's a good idea in a club to have somebody whose sole responsibility is running the debate and will stand in front. I don't mean, it's obviously the responsibility of the squire and the foreman to achieve standards. We also need other members of the club to be concerned about what's going on. As we know, it's very easy to get absorbed in actually trying to get what we want out of people. You need somebody else to stand there to say, well, I was watching the other two. And that sort of thing. You need somebody. I know our side, but that's a proper post. Some of the old man of the team, as it were, who actually is preserving standards. And that's why I look at it and say, well, we're not doing as well and so on. And being an official post, you're there to have to listen. Whereas too often you just say, well, what they are. What are standards? Well, I said, if you're going the wrong way, we can't raise standards and model them. We look at people. You have to look at everybody in your form. Everybody in your sign is an individual. Once you start thinking of them as a mob or connection, you're losing touch. You have to put 10 or dozen people, you can have a direct relationship with that person. That's why you're that sign of in the first place, right? And you have to recognize that some people are having technical difficulties, or memory difficulties, or other personal difficulties, all of which you as leader and the other club members have a responsibility to respond to. You need to see what's going on, and you've got to get it out to where you can actually criticize somebody face to face, not necessarily in front of you have to have a mechanism where you say, look, I'm speaking from good faith, I believe your technique on this is not very good, and so on. What can we do? You're not doing what we can do to actually overcome this particular problem. Right? It's like in your cricket team, perhaps. When you're not doing very well, you suddenly get a lot of attention paid to you, and they have organised themselves with a batting coach and a bowling coach and this, that and the other. Carl Morris clubs aren't that. Don't have that number of people available to do it. Yeah. In the end, come back to being the group that we started the day with. How do we actually work together as a group? And the fact we have a common purpose, common objective, and we're there to help each other do things. Which is why, to do that, you actually need all these little tidbits of information that you're trying to open windows onto, saying, hey, you know, your sitting stick-up will not be good because you they say, oh, you can't throw your sieve. This is how you throw a sieve, sort of thing. Or come over here and explain it to you. You can't do it very well yourself. And don't be afraid to use, say, other people's wrong ones. Other people in the club want you to do something better than you do. There's nothing wrong with delegation. After being a leader, a foreman, or a squire or something, they've already been delegated authority, as it were, and you can delegate the task of whoever you like. You just carry the cannon, you know, you are responsible in the end, to the team or to the club by a safety what actually turned there to be. You know, you've got to be prepared. I don't know if you've had this in this life, you actually sound like a big candidate. Be responsible for the responsibility you have. You can't actually just say, I'm strong, do what I say, and you're so. Well, it's 25. That gives us all 15 minutes of discussion time, if you want. Very good, I think I've already said that I would like you to write it from Ted Rosser. Stand up.
Which one?
We have now shaved Ted Rosser. Now's your chance to speak.
So, something, yes. What I promised to do is give the note form for what's going on today. So what I think the best I sent out to the headings, which will give you what happened, I'll try to back them out.
Yes.
Thank you. I'll find you that
place
if you're
otherwise you can come on back. That'll be 1:13 then. I can give you the numbers.
1:13.
Well. I can give you one letter to it.
Yes, I guess so.
Sure. But please feel you know, responding to things like this is how from the Federation. Because we've got to crack. We might say, from our answer, this is the Millennium project for the Federation. It's actually sort of what it is supposed to do.
We'll figure it out.
Roy, can I ask you a question totally unconnected with the organisation? A technical question about what you were just talking about. About the characters. What most Morris teams spend most of their time practicing rather than dancing out. Like most teams spend 7 or 8 months of the year going to practice and then 4 months of the year dancing out. What is the role of the non-dancing members of the team during that large portion of the year? The reason I'm saying this is I can think of at least one person in the past who seemed to think his role was to be a bloody nuisance most of the time, at least that's the way he came across. But of course, he wanted, because he had a role when we were out, but not when we were practicing, he wanted his views to be taken into consideration as much as everybody else. But a lot of people thought, well, who the bloody hell is he? I've only seen him twice since Christmas, you know.
Well, there's one golden rule that you practice how you're going to perform out. And if you have disorganised practices, then you're inevitably disorganised when you're out. It's very simple. But you fall back, when under stress, you fall back into your normal mode of doing things, which in fact is the way you go on in practices. And if you shamble on to make up a set, and then you just stand around and criticise each other with getting off, and things like that, in practice, you'll end up doing that outside as often as not. And you know, I've seen that too often to know that it's not true. No, I know that it's true at all. You actually need a practice, to practice at all, from coming on to getting off. And that includes what these characters are going to do. It ought to be practicing the announcements. It ought to, on some occasions, allowing the clown to see what it is, so you have some idea what having a character marching around, threatening you, or dancing through the set, is actually going to involve. But the only person who doesn't practice is the collector. Yeah. Although that might be a way of actually raising cup glasses. socialise, and then dress up and go out to a pub and socialise, and at the same time make a bit of noise and dance around. Expect the audience to respond to you in the way that you're treating them. You know, you're just, people aren't taking it very seriously, because you're not taking anything seriously as well. There's nothing wrong with that attitude. All that's wrong is when people don't take themselves seriously, expect the audience to.
When you say what to the animals, they don't want to feed you, but when you say you have to, when you say practice, you have to think of the opportunities you've thought.
I'm sure there are sides who profess not to pursue excellence, but actually would like to be excellent. What you have to do is recognise your own limitations in the end. Set yourself targets you would have achieved, and so on. And this comes really into the arguments here about things like competitions. Why would Fleet enter the Port of Music Festival? Well, I know what it is. I stand here with my stick. Dancing. I'd never imagined when I started that people would do more as well.
left the Seven Champions show, and she was excited. What a wonderful change from Norris dancing, she said.
I suspect you take it as a compliment, actually.
I think they would, actually.
They're all right for that. See them all at once.
You put out leaflets to audience and ask them what they thought. What sort of things did you say? What sort of things in your experience are we?
Oh, they saw it as a way of upsetting the side that was dancing, as much as anything else. You know, I don't think they were on the statements.
Oh,
yeah, I wasn't tending to get people prepared to stand up or hand fit in the form and hand it over. You know, that was the problem. No, I misjudged it. The thing I think about the Morris Award is now I can up now, let's be fair, 10,000 people, that's comparable to judo, archery, gymnast, gym counts, you know, things of that sort. But we are a minor level sport requiring some specialist knowledge, some special equipment and background to do. We should be considered as respectful as the other, as all these others. We are large enough for an infinite variety of attitudes to exist. In fact, the Morris, I think, allows each club to be different from every other club of issues. And that really is the beauty of the Morris. Particularly, you see, you perhaps don't appreciate it, but back in 1951, if you saw a Morris side, the only way you could tell it different from another was the colour of its baldry. Although they didn't explain to you that each team had different colour baldries, because you never actually saw a side all had the same colour baldry in On Friday night, most clubs spent the night eating, throwing the rain, trying to find their fifth, sixth, dancer, as it were, and so on. And again, that was argued on one occasion. There were six of you from five clubs, and five versions of trumpets between you. And you had to decide, you rapidly learned how to just do your own thing. Now, you've got the knowledge of all this, you've got to find out what to do something different.
Can I make a point on, you were talking about people's attitude to Morris. Last night, in the early hours of the morning, snogging over the hot stove, there was a skip program on the they were saying the various things that were happening there with these prison ships sailing up the tunnel, up the Thames, and that the SAS came in dressed as Morris men and they then scaled the top of the Greenwich Tower and danced there. And I thought, we might be interested in that.
Talk to me about it, it's my habit. also talk about is how there's money from the lottery, which is available, which for local groups, which developing arts with the local community and particularly youth groups. And there's small grants up to £5,000, or there's ones for £500,000. That's the one that's been floating around over in the shop. There is a telephone number. It might be worthwhile individual teams taking the number and ringing up for their own calls and see if you actually get some money to do something local in your own area. Certainly, it's one of the things that we'll be discussing at the meeting, whether or not we can put something together on a bigger scale for the Forest Federation. But we'll also be people at that meeting from Open Morris and from the Sorry, Sorry,
Well, we have 2 minutes left. Right, thank you very much. We go to all the other thank you very much. Marguerite?
Yes, thank you.
Thank you all very much.